Since the government's launched its wellbeing budget last year, which signalled a strong intent to transform New Zealand's mental health system, developments have been watched closely by the commission set up to monitor progress. In a moment, we'll speak to the initial Mental Health and Wellbeing Commissioner, Hayden Wano. But first, let's just recap about how we got to this point. In 2018, the Heo Ara Oranga report into mental health and addiction was published following an inquiry. It found there was a strong need for a new direction and helped set a pathway with four main priorities, which the government accepted. Those being launching a suicide prevention strategy and office, setting up a mental health and wellbeing commission, reforming and repealing the Mental Health Act, and expanding access to and choice of services. So, has the government been doing what it said it would following the inquiry? To answer that, we have Commissioner Hayden Wano, who joins me now from Taranaki. Good morning.
Morena, Hayley.
So you're about to publish this report. Can you just give us an indication first on what the government has been getting right?
Okay, I think the four priorities were the rollout that the government had committed to, and so that was that's the focus of this report. He Ara Oranga, in fact, has another set of 20-odd recommendations that aren't included in this particular report. So their commitment, the government commitment, has been strong in terms of leading the way, and there's been really good alignment with what the public are saying and what the sector and the system itself are wanting to see. So that's a good starting point.
So has commitment and words and intent actually led to delivery?
Yeah, well, I think it's important that we start to recalibrate expectations, because transformation by its very nature is going to take time.
Right.
And so that's important to understand that the process that the processes that have started by government, if you're close to the action, if you're close to, say, like the ministry and so forth, then there's a lot of activity going on and you're starting to see some programs being rolled out across the country. For example, in the primary care area, you've seen increased access and choice in that area. And that's pretty much covered close to covering most of the country. But these are very early signs. And so the general feedback that we've received in this particular report, and I just want to emphasise this is a check-in. This isn't the full report. We've got a full report scheduled for later in the year in November. And we'll be able to do a more complete job at that stage. But what we would say is that there is more to do. There's definitely more to do.
What the government has done is committed funding. There is money flowing into the system.
Yes.
But the report has highlighted concerns about whether that's getting to the right place and is it actually flowing down to where it needs to be. Where is the money going and how can we ensure that it gets to the right place?
So the money, first of all, the money is spread over a number of years. That's the first point. So, and it's important that it gets to the right place. And at the moment, the way the money is flowing is basically based on traditional procurement rules, and they're somewhat more restrictive. And what people are saying in the community, and I think you had you interviewed somebody from Alzheimer's New Zealand earlier in the week, and what's happening is that those rules have not been able to engage with providers and communities in the way that they would like. So there's a strong desire to actually partner on the way funding flows through the system, the way their services are designed and so forth. And so that's the missing element at this stage. We're still looking to fund existing services or new services using traditional ways of funding. And it typically leaves the community out, the provider out of the conversation, the people with lived experience. And that's where the focus needs to go.
There are, of course, existing providers who are out there doing the mahi. How can we ensure, especially for those who are providing services to Māori and Pacific Island communities, how can we ensure that they are actually getting that partnership with the government and then finding the funding they need?
Yes. So that's, I think part of that is being able to actually sit down at the table right from the outset. What we've seen with some of these early investments is actually using some of the, as I said, some of the traditional ways of funding. But we've started to see some early signs with kaupapa Māori providers, Pacific providers, and people with and working with people with lived experience in mental health and addiction services starting to be engaged. They're very early signs, but there needs to be much more of a stronger commitment to that. It's resonated through a number of different reports recently. You've got a similar theme flowing through in the Health and Disability Review. You've had the report from Peter Gluckman and Richie Poulton, Koi Tu, echoing a similar voice. You had the Mental Health Commissioner last week coming through. So there needs to be a stronger engagement between people in the system and the people who use it and the communities in interest.
Very quickly, do you think that the government needs to trust the community and those providers who are in the community more?
Yeah, good point. I think we saw a fantastic example of what can happen under a very difficult situation in COVID-19. And I acknowledge that there were many challenges, of course, for people who were affected by COVID-19, but it also showed how the system could respond. And I think the two takeaway lines from the COVID-19 experience would be speed, urgency, and collaboration, and how quickly, in a high trust environment, you can translate a policy conversation into something happening on the ground in a matter of hours, if not days. And it's that example that I think we should continue to be drawing on. And as I mentioned before, that through those other reports, that's been confirmed, and we need to see more of it.
That's a beautiful point to end on. Thank you so much, Hayden Wano, for the Mental Health and Wellbeing Commissioner. Thank you for your time.